Okay, folks, we're here to interview David Ramsay Steele on
Interrogate.
the what, the renegade.
Interrogate, you said.
Interrogate, if possible. I think Roger's got the thumbscrews. Alex is coming along with the fire pit. But yes, we're here to have a conversation about David Ramsay Steele's new book, A Conquistador with His Pants Down. And straight off, that raises the question, why that particular title?
Well, it's the title of one of the chapters. These are all actually, they're not previously published things, but a few of them are. So that each chapter has a title, and that chapter is a previously published one, and it has the title "The Conquistador with His Pants Down." It's about Sigmund Freud, who wrote to his friend Wilhelm Fliess that he was not a scientist but a conquistador. So it's a debunking piece about Freud, showing that Freud was a crook and a con man. And when he reported his cases, his main claim to fame was that he found a method of psychotherapy that worked. It was most important because when he faced questions about this method of psychotherapy and the theory that girded it, he replied by saying that it worked, that he had successes. Well, he didn't have any successes, and his reports of his cases are false. Because what Freud did was in those cases, and I remember reading this in the early 1960s when I first read Freud, and I was quite impressed by it, because what Freud said was that all of his patients, as he called them, we would say in psychotherapy today, clients, but you know, he was a medical man, or so he would like you to believe, and he said that all of his patients had told him that they had been, as he put it, seduced by their fathers in early childhood. Now, in fact, we know that not one of these patients ever told Freud that they had been seduced by their fathers in early childhood. So
How do we know? How do we know that?
how do we know that? Because if you look at all the references, you see, when Freud wrote this, he had only ever had about less than 20, I think it was 18 patients. So psychoanalysis is an interminable thing that goes on, and they keep shelling out the money for the analyst. So those were his cases. So in his earliest reference to these cases, he states that patients had no memory whatsoever of this seduction. And he would browbeat them and scream at them and try to convince them that this had happened, and they were totally incredulous. But then what he did was he said that they had told him something. What he meant was that it was his interpretation of their symptoms. You see, it's a bit like saying if somebody makes a big raise before the flop, they're telling you that they have two aces. Well, that's not literally true. They're not telling you anything. So in that sense, he was using the word metaphorically. But as time went on and he made repeated reference to the same cases, he allowed people to think that they had literally said, "I was seduced by my father in early childhood." And the odd thing about all this is it should be transparent that there's something wrong with this, because his whole theory is that you repress these memories of this seduction in early childhood because it's too horrible to contemplate, so you don't know anything about it. So how could they have told him? Well, the answer is they said, I've been anxious, or I've had these symptoms of psychological disturbance. And he said, "Ah, that means you're telling me when you say that you were seduced by your father." Now, I should explain to those who don't know anything about Freud that he went through a brief period where he claimed that these so-called seductions, what we would call molestations actually, that had actually occurred. But after a little more than a year, he switched to saying they had not occurred, but they had been fantasized unconsciously by the patients. So this was what disturbs the patients, according to psychoanalysis, what disturbs you is that you have this fantasy when you're 2 or 3 or 4 years old that your father has had sex with you. So you make up this story only in your unconscious. You don't know about it. And the job of psychoanalysis is to uncover this repressed memory. But in psychoanalysis proper, it's not that that a repressed memory of actual seduction or molestation. Yeah. It's a fantasized memory.
Right. So from the philosophy of science, in particular, Karl Popper, we do know that all observations are theory laden. However, in the case of Freud, theoretical interpretations of what his patients are saying, that's perhaps going a little bit far, a little bit too far. In fact, you're going so far as to say that Freud was a liar and a con man.
Yes. And this is pretty generally accepted by people who've studied the matter. Actually, that chapter, I wrote it, I forget when it was, but it was back in the 2000s, I think. And I only give a few sources, but they were the crucial sources. Frank Cioffi is one of them. Alan Esterson is another. And there are a few people who did little bits of this detective work to show that what Freud reported could not possibly have happened. Mm. Now there is a much richer literature, and I wish in my appendix where I explain the origins of these chapters that I had pointed out the great contribution of Frederick Cruz, who has really written. He wrote the masterwork Freud: The Making of an Illusion, which of course is a reference to an allusion to Freud's book, The Future of an Illusion, which is about belief in God, where Freud was an atheist, and he wrote a book called The Future of an Illusion about religion. So Frederick Cruz wrote this wonderful book which synthesizes everything we know about Freud and is very, very detailed and goes into all kinds of little intricacies that you would never suspect from reading my piece. But the basic point has survived. People who objectively look at what Freud did and said have to agree he was a liar and a con man. Now, if you say he's a liar, it's part of lying that you know you're trying to deceive the person you're talking to. So there is a question of to what extent Freud was actually deluded and therefore not lying when he said something. And there's still a little bit of room for argument there.
Yeah, because there's a kind of a shady area between straight out lying and being economical with the truth.
Right.
Especially if it evolves over time.
Right, yeah, exactly. Yeah. I mean it's amazing actually to me, looking back, how credulous I was in the early 1960s when I read. I remember vividly reading Two Short Accounts of Psychoanalysis, which I think had just come out in Penguin. But anyway, it had just come to my attention in Penguin. And I thought, and I was quite impressed by it. He's a good writer.
Yeah.
He's a good writer. He's a persuasive writer. Mm. And he uses certain rhetorical tricks, which are very effective. And one of the rhetorical tricks he uses is, He will confess to his own inadequacy, but his own inadequacy is that he didn't immediately see his brilliant theory. And in fact, he says in one point, when they told me they'd been seduced by their father, I just accepted this. Now you might think I was very credulous, and that I must say I blame myself for being so credulous. But the point is, they never told him that. So there was nothing to be credulous about.
Yes.
I don't know anything about Freud, but it sounds like he made a lot of it up. There's a huge amount of room for interpretation and misperception. And
the whole thing's
overrated.
Every little child wants to have sex with his mother and kill his father. Everyone. Yeah, you know, everybody. The Oedipal phase applies to absolutely everyone, and you know, this is a bit staggering. you know.
It's crazy to me. How can a child know anything when it's 3 year old or whatever?
Right, exactly.
I mean, what's his database? Any of his customers or patients? Are they, well, the people who come in saying they've got problems, I suppose.
Yes.
But
well, they've got, you can say
it
that
seems
they had.
Strange that they're the same cause for all of the problems, and
right.
Just doesn't seem credible, really.
But you wouldn't have suspected that Freud was a con man. That's a revelation, isn't it?
Yeah.
Roger.
I guess, yes. I wouldn't have got, well,
he's still a highly revered intellectual.
Yeah, I'd have just thought he was not really, you know, relevant, but to then say that he's made it all up for his own whatever self-interest, whatever his motivation is, I wouldn't have thought that particularly, no.
I mean, because he's still presented within many circles as the Copernicus of intellectual world, you know, within psychology in particular.
Okay. Anyway, you've answered the question about Conquistador, because my first thought was, as an historian, would have been it's something to do with the Spanish conquest of the Americas, but obviously people into it will be aware that Freud wrote a book with that title, and that's where you got it from. It's fair enough.
Well, he didn't write, it's not in the title of Freud's book. It's in a letter he wrote to a guy called Wilhelm Fleiss. And so he did say, I'm not a scientist, I'm a conquistador, which is a remarkable thing to say, actually, since he was claiming to the world to be not only a scientist, but a revolutionary breakthrough scientist who transformed psychology.
So in what sense was he portraying himself in the letter as a conquistador? Was it as an adventurer or
a seeker of
gold?
I remember the passage literally, and he says, I am a conquistador, and of course it's a letter in German, but I'm translating into English. So he says, I'm a conquistador, or if you want it translated, an adventurer.
Yes.
And not a scientist, and not a scientist.
Which is, it's rather odd, that, isn't it?
Well, I mean, you know, it's a letter to a friend he later fell out with. And a friend who was just as crazy as he was. But because Wilhelm Fleiss thought that all the psychological problems, especially of women, were to do with the nose. So he operated on people's noses. No, this is absolutely true.
That is frightening.
He did surgery on people's noses. This is all pretty trivial now. Because in general, I would say that it's very important to understand the origins of psychoanalysis. Because although psychoanalysis in its pure form has lost a lot of influence, and very few people now believe it. Certain general features of psychoanalysis have become part of everyday wisdom. I mean, for example, the idea that if you have a psychological problem like overeating or feeling anxious or whatever, it's probably due to some trauma from your early childhood, and that the way to tackle this problem is to excavate what really happened to you in early childhood.
Yes.
All this is, in my view, absolutely and totally wrong. But anyway, let's put it more mildly and say there isn't any conclusive evidence for it.
I would concur with that. I would think it's the circumstances that you're under, not something that happened decades previously in most cases.
Right.
Yeah, I mean, just to conclude that, there's a number of things I could say, but it is strange for him to claim that he isn't a scientist, although there's a very small snippet from a letter that you said, because in other places he does say that he looked forward to a day when psychoanalysis would be a deterministic science, that everything would be true, that mental life itself would be reduced to neurological processes.
Yes.
So he was very much a reductionist, but yeah.
But that was something he sort of purported to believe in. I'm sure he did believe in it, but it really would show, if it were true, that psychoanalysis can't be true, right? It can't, it's contradictory. Right. But if you say that that people's psychological problems have something to do with their ideas and with the meanings of things,
yes,
you're saying it can't be reduced to neuroscience. Plato's Republic cannot be reduced to subatomic motions in Plato's head. It has a meaning.
Yes.
You know, it has a semantics, or you might say more cautiously.
Mm-hmm. Okay, Roger's going to steam ahead with some questions here.
So, obviously, there's a lot of what to me seem varying things, but is there an overall consistent theme to the book?
Well, I was asked this question several times before, actually. I just sort of put it together as some of my recent pieces I'd written or could write. Actually, some of the pieces are just talks I've given, and I only wrote them up for this book. So they couldn't have appeared anywhere else. Others, it's not quite so clear. But I didn't have an idea there's going to be a consistent theme, except that they all tend to be something to do with libertarianism in one form or another. But it did occur to me more after it was all put together that there is something that keeps cropping up. Mm. And that is that there are what I call religions, although some people object to it, like global warming catastrophism, like transgenderism, like psychoanalysis, like Marxism. So my view is that it's a fact, it's just a fact, that in industrialized capitalism, there is automatically an enfeeblement of traditional religion based on supernatural entities. That kind of religion declines, but people have an appetite for belief systems that they can commit to. And so you get new religions, which always, as far as I can't think of any exceptions, always present themselves as being science-based, as being scientific. So, you know, Marxism made a big deal about how it was scientific. Freudianism, psychoanalysis, made a big deal about being scientific. Global warming, catastrophism, they accuse anybody who criticizes them or even asks innocent questions of being anti-scientific. So it seems to me that we have a definite, it's just a fact. It's not something I'm recommending or denigrating. It's just a fact that in industrialized capitalism, traditional religions, especially in the West, we think of Christianity, Judaism, and Islam as being very similar religions that are based on the belief in a God. These kinds of religions decline. And people who use the percentage of people in the population who used to be committed to them declines. And instead of this leading to a religion-less society, it leads to these new belief systems, these new religions, which claim to be science-based. So, so my view is that the new religions are at least as dangerous to human freedom as the old religions. And so that is one thing that keeps cropping up in the book. Yes, I didn't design the book that way, but it is a preoccupation of mine that we do have these new religions, which are science, claim to be scientific, although I think that doesn't save them from being seriously mistaken. And in fact, unscientific. Scientific isn't really a term you should throw around as a term of praise. I mean, we should talk about the evidence. We should talk about the coherence of the arguments and things like that rather than...
Exactly. And the method.
And the method, rather than labeling people as unscientific.
Right. So then you go on to talk about what you call mass delusions, mm-hmm. and how mass delusions start. But I'm thinking one person's mass delusion is another person's logical truth, aren't they?
Well, people have different opinions, and since a delusion is a false opinion or an untrue belief, yes, that's true. But of course, there is an objective fact of the matter about this. Some things are wrong and some things are right.
Right. I go with that.
So I do have the chapter, which is probably, I suppose, the most contentious, in all probability, the most contentious chapter, where I look at Lysenkoism, which was a doctrine that was propounded in the Soviet Union, beginning in the 30s and lasting up until the 60s. Actually, it strikes me that people below a certain age are not really aware of the communist movement as it used to be. Essentially, the USSR was ruled by a communist party. And in every country in the world, there was a communist party which was loyal to the Soviet Union. And all these communist parties were founded in the period 1919 to 1921, because the Bolsheviks, having finally decided by 1919 that maybe the world revolution wasn't going to happen next weekend, they had to sort of come to terms with the fact that they were isolated in Russia. And they had to come to terms with the fact, how did they stand in relation to Marxists and socialists who had various organizations in every country. And what they decided to do was to set up a new communist international. And it was called the Communist International, or Comintern, or Third International. It's the same thing. And so there would be a communist party in every country, which would be loyal to the head office of the Communist International, which in fact would be controlled by the Soviet government. Now, everybody who was a member of a communist party was under discipline, and that meant that they had to preach the communist party doctrine to the rest of the world. And this could be about all kinds of matters. For example, the communist party was against abstract art. This was a sign of decadent bourgeois imperialism. And you couldn't be a member of a communist party and go around saying abstract art is great, and I'm a big believer in abstract art. You couldn't be a Freudian. You couldn't favor jazz music and so on. And you couldn't favor stream of consciousness novels like James Joyce. So there were all kinds of things where you had to mold your opinions in accordance with the Communist International, which was in practice controlled by the government of the USSR, which meant that after a certain point sometime in the early to mid 20s, it was controlled by Joseph Stalin. So one of the things you had to believe in and had to propagate if you were a member of a communist party, any communist party, was this doctrine called Lysenkoism. Most people in the English-speaking world say Lysenko, but I've listened to people talking about this guy in both Russian and Ukrainian, and they pronounce it Lysenko. So anyway, so Lysenkoism was a view about agricultural science, and it was a view about biology, and it basically was utterly opposed to the right-wing bourgeois science of genetics, totally opposed to genetics. It laid an emphasis.
Question, Roger, because you wondered what Lysenkoism
was. I never heard of it. I mean, I know a fair bit about history and obviously the communism. And this is a subsection within communism.
All communists had to be Lysenkoists.
Yeah, so that's the point, isn't it? They all had to be the same,
Because Stalin was a Lysenkoist, you see, and any opinion Stalin had was automatically became binding upon all communists.
Mm.
So the empirical basis for this Lysenkoism was that, for example, if you take grains of wheat that are going to be used as seeds, right, and you re- the under certain conditions, if you reduce the temperature to a very low temperature, that you're keeping these seeds. Yeah, if you treat these seeds in a certain way, for example, by greatly reducing the temperature for a spell, they then behave differently when they germinate and when the crops grow. So there are things you can do to seeds which will affect the way the crops will grow later. Mm. So this is you can see how this is in harmony with the communist view that people are conditioned to a large extent by their environment. So the whole idea was that in building socialism, you were building the basis for creating what was called a new man, a new kind of human personality.
Yeah.
And so it was very much in harmony with this that you rejected genetics in favor of this process of treating grains in a certain way so that they would grow better later. And so this held out great promise for being able to revolutionize agriculture and yield a more abundant supply of foodstuffs. Now, in fact, Lysenkoism never worked, so it didn't work in terms of improving agriculture. In fact, it was pretty disastrous. But you were obliged to agree with it. And people who didn't agree with it, geneticists and people like that, in some cases lost their jobs, in some cases were taken away and shot. So this was, you might say, political correctness. So there were some So what was the reaction of people who were not members of communist parties to this? So, for example, there was a communist party in Britain called the Communist Party of Great Britain, CPGB. All its members had to preach Lysenkoism. There was you'd be expelled from the party if you said anything in favor of genetics.
So it spread out?
Oh, yeah. I mean, if you were a member of the CPGB in the 30s or 40s and you said something in public in favor of genetics or psychoanalysis or abstract art or jazz, you'd be expelled.
So they couldn't even talk about it.
This is the point I'm trying to make.
Can't mention Mendel's name.
It's all about central control, isn't it? The details, I mean, in a sense, don't matter. It's about central control, and anybody who disagreed is, you know, a pariah, expelled, etc.
The point is, younger people may not know this about the communist movement, that they weren't allowed any heresies.
Yes.
You would be drummed out of the movement if you said something that was against the party line, and the party line wasn't confined to politics or economics. People who were outside the communist orbit completely and had no particular connection with communism, if they knew anything about biology, they tended to view this Lysenkoism as a kind of crackpot pseudoscience. Mm. So how did it come to prevail in the communist movement, and in particular in the USSR? Well, they usually explained this by the lack of democracy. It was because there was no democracy and no freedom of speech that something like this could gain ground. So that was their view. There were actually some biologists who were sympathetic to the Soviet Union who reacted in different ways. In the famous case of JBS Haldane, who was leading biologist, but who was sympathetic to communism. And he sort of, let's say, he was equivocal. He tended to, by omission, to be somewhat more favorable to Lysenkoism than any normal biologist would be. On the other hand, there were other biologists like Julian Huxley who were broadly sympathetic. They were left-wing in their views and tended to favor the Soviet Union, but they just said this is nonsense and they attacked. My view is that we now witness analogous movements in Western democracies. So the question is, how is that possible? Now, some people might disagree with my choice. I say the low-fat diet, which was promoted by Ansel Keys, in the 50s and 60s, and which became orthodoxy, the idea that heart disease and various other ailments are due to eating saturated fat and due to a high cholesterol count. That is an example of a pseudoscience which became orthodoxy. People were persecuted.
Okay, so that brings us nicely to the chapter on Marx then.
Uh-huh.
You're critical of Marxism and you reckon that there cannot be another Marxist revolution. Perhaps you'd like to
say. There has never been a Marxist revolution, and I'm saying there never can be. I'm saying there never can be.
Right.
Can we start that again? I think it's not a question of whether there can be a revolution. It's a question whether you can actually move from capitalism to communism.
Okay. Fair enough.
And maybe can you show us your chin? I'll edit that.
Oh, right. Now it's gone.
Your chin keeps disappearing again.
Hang on.
That's fine. We've got you framed. You're framed now.
Yeah, I've always been framed.
Yeah, you've always. Yeah,
I complain about it, but the police take no notice. They keep framing me.
Yeah, it's just outrageous. Do you accept that reframing of your question?
Yeah, because obviously a lot hinges on what you mean by a Marxist revolution, doesn't it? So you're saying we're talking about a revolution as Marx envisaged it, and the idea that communism is automatically, according to the deterministic theory, replace capitalism at some point. Is that? Yeah.
I claim that communist society, as Marx conceived it, cannot exist. I also claim that, contrary to what Marx thought, capitalism is not evolving in the direction of communism.
Can I just step in there and really emphasize the import of that word impossible? It cannot exist. It's as impossible as a cat swimming the Atlantic. I think that probably puts it at the level that you mean.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah, it's a fairly absolute claim that you're making. Yeah. And the reasons for that are, you've got two.
Well, I give two reasons. One is the economic calculation argument, which was put forward by Ludwig von Mises in 1920. His argument is basically that a modern industrial society capable of delivering high living standards to the masses has to have a functioning price system. Because if it doesn't have that, it can't appropriately make economic comparisons and it can't say what's more costly than what else. So that's one argument. And of course, the point is that the early Marxists thought of communism as a society with high living standards. In fact, they thought of it as a society with much higher living standards than capitalism. So so Mises showed, I think, that if you abolish the financial system, if you abolish money, if you abolish calculation in terms of monetary units, then you cannot have that kind of a high industrial output. In fact, you will impoverish society because you won't have a way of telling misallocations from optimal allocations. So the other argument I give is...
Can I stop you there? Because can we elaborate this just a little? Because I think it's worthwhile elaborating Ludwig von Mises' economic calculation argument. Because so many times I've heard people come back with, well, isn't that just, you know, the calculation problem? Isn't that just a matter of accounting? And surely accounting is advanced by orders of magnitude since Ludwig von Mises penned that argument. Yeah, you get this argument coming back with, that's just a question of financial accounting.
No, but can't
we just account on physical products?
Well, it's not just a matter of accounting. You can run a business without accounting, although I wouldn't advise it. But there is a question of whether a business is paying for itself, meaning is it yielding a greater output than the inputs it uses up? Because if the costs are too great in relation to the output of the business, then under a capitalist system, that would indicate the business should be either closed down or shrunk. It should be curtailed in some way because it's not paying its way. Now, this aspect of running production, organizing production in an industrial society, what it means is you have to have a way of looking at all the different inputs you use. And in a typical business, there will be thousands of such inputs. And they all have to be compared so that you can come up with a unified concept of how much things are costing. And this is made possible because we have a money economy in which goods are priced. And Marx thought of the future communist society as having no money. Later, various Marxists admitted there would be money, but purely as a way to ration consumer goods. In other words, money wouldn't be used in organizing production. So when Mises made this argument in 1920, most Marxists accepted that there would be money to ration consumer goods, but they didn't accept that money prices would have any role in organizing production. And what Mises was saying was, in order to organize production, you need to do your accounting in terms of money prices. Now, it's a bit more complicated than this, because what people do in the market is they don't just read off money prices. They anticipate future money prices and future incomes and so on. So it's actually a bit more complicated, but just reducing it to its simple essentials, without a market that creates prices for goods, there's no way to cost goods. There's no way to know. So there's no way to decide, even provisionally, whether one method of production is superior to another.
Yeah. So I must admit, I was a bit confused of what this Mises argument is, but that what you said at the beginning is a very clear argument, answer to my question. For anybody who wants to know what Mises is, it's about how you calculate the real cost of whatever, production, producing things, and that you need a price mechanism. I'm okay with that.
But playing the devil's advocate here, though, isn't cost just a matter of amount of money lost?
Well, I don't think we need to go further. You need a mechanism to decide what costs that and what costs something else. Now, whether you want to go on to that, that's it really. Doesn't necessarily. You could then say, well, we can produce stuff even if it's more expensive. I mean, we're back to this, isn't an art business.
Yeah, what is cost? Is it just money?
Well, it's what? Now,
if without money, we wouldn't need to take account of costs.
Right. I'm not getting rid of money. So
I'm trying to be a naive person coming to socialism, or just accepted socialism. And I'm thinking, well, all this argument of Mises' argument is based on playing with finances. And it's money. It's either paper money or it's digital money. Where's the cost there?
Right.
What's cost?
So your question is what?
Well,
I'm accepting the
answer. If we don't have money, then we don't need to take account of costs. So the argument, Mises' argument, doesn't apply to communism.
Possibly.
Well,
you could say that.
You have said similar things, because you've said that the financial system is just about printing money and generating derivatives.
Well, it can be now. Derivatives are a recent invention, aren't they?
But aren't those?
I'm accepting what David said in his first answer, that you need a mechanism to decide, is it cheaper to build a thing out of bricks or gold
Yes.
And that's obvious one, but you need a mechanism to actually prove that.
Yes.
So that's...
I mean, I think the point is, to answer what Ray just said, the point is that we're aware of costs in the marketplace because of money prices. Yeah. But that doesn't mean that cost as a phenomenon is created by money prices. Right. It's just that money prices are a way to detect something that would have to be detected in any system of organized, any complicated system of organizing production. And the reason is that there are many thousands of different inputs and they have to be compared. If you have a method of production that uses more of some inputs but less of others, you have to reduce those two kinds of inputs to a common measure in order to say that one method of production is more efficient than the other.
Right, so I accept that. I mean, the only quibbles will be, is the money system accurate in actually getting the correct answer to that, given that there's speculation in the markets as well, obviously, which might distort things.
Yes,
speculation always aids, is always an equilibrating force. Speculation enables the whole pricing system to be more accurate as a reflection of real quantities. So speculation is all on the side of improving marketplace allocations. Now, there are all kinds of detailed criticisms that might be made of a particular, of the way market prices develop in a particular legal system. If you change the legal system, it's going to have some, there are going to be changes in money prices. And what we want is a system of money prices that is most accurate in terms of real relationships. In other words, real resources. And you can talk about, you can have detailed arguments about modifying the financial system through the law in order to change what, but it's not going to revolutionize money prices. It's just going to be adjustments here and adjustments there. I mean, the most obvious example would be if there is a cost that isn't taken into account. And the classic example of this would be pollution, that someone who's running a factory that's polluting the environment is not paying some of the costs because they're not taking into account the problems of the pollution. Well, the answer to that would be to have a legal system which internalizes those costs, where people, you know, if they're going to pollute and harm other people, that they have to pay to do that, or they have to be prohibited from doing it. There are different ways of looking at this. So the financial system produces prices which have certain qualities, and these can be modified in various ways. But that doesn't mean that money prices are absolutely crazy and that something totally different would work as well. That doesn't follow at all. Basically, if you look at modern price theory, neoclassical price theory, and say, what is cost? The answer is that cost is what you give up when you choose to use resources in a particular way. If you use resources in a particular way, those resources are not being used in many, many thousands or millions of other ways. In order to take into account that, you would need something called general equilibrium. You'd need to look at all the different possibilities for substitution, possibilities for complementary goods, and so on. It'd be dizzyingly complex, and in fact, it isn't done. You know, but you can use general equilibrium theory to describe how the market does it. Now, Marx had the idea, and his early followers, all had the idea that all costs could be reduced to labor. And so they thought that in a communist society, you could use labor hours, labor time, as a unit of account. Now, there are all kinds of reasons why that won't work. So
it's clear you're saying that we need costs, and that method of using money is the best method of determining accurately as you can what the costs are. So, yeah. So Marxist revolution required some other mechanism to determine that, and because there isn't another mechanism that's as good as that, that's why we can't have that aspect of a Marxist revolution.
Right. Now, the other argument against the possibility of Marxian communism is due to Robert Michels, or he changed his, he moved to Italy and called himself Roberto in the later stage of his life. But his name is Michels, M-I-C-H-E-L-S. Oh. And he pointed out that he observed something and then went on to analyze it and explain why it was true. That if you have a large and complicated organization, it's always run by a few people. And this took a long time for people to understand, and there may be some people who still don't understand it. They have this idea of what you could call participatory democracy, or in American, participatory democracy, right? So the idea is that everybody gets involved in decision-making, and somehow spontaneously out of this comes a democratic decision. And now there are all kinds of problems with that idea, but one problem is that if you have a large, complicated organization, there is going to be a division between the officers of that organization, the leaders, and the led, or the masses, or the members, the ordinary members. You can't get away from this. You never find a large, complicated organization which isn't actually run by a handful of people. So given that that's the case, what that means is that the administration of a communist society would actually be done by a handful of people. Each organization would be run by very few people. It's not feasible to have a continuous decision making where everybody's involved. That can't happen.
You're getting excited over that argument.
It's interesting. So we're saying that Marx then wanted to abolish all these organizations ultimately, didn't he?
No. Marx thought there would be vast organizations, huge organizations, but he thought they would be that they could be related to by people in terms of participatory democracy, and that's a misunderstanding of organizations and the way they operate.
Yeah, so that's interesting. Sorry, I got that wrong. He said the state would.
Calm down.
He said the state would disappear, didn't he? Not these organizations. But there's another interesting implication for that, though, not just that aspect of Marxism couldn't work, but it's an argument against democracy, isn't it? A proper democracy where it's the people deciding things and we're limiting ourselves to sort of parliamentary or representative democracy where you vote, but you're entrusting the actual day-to-day decision-making to some sort of hierarchical system that is then from whatever, is unaccountable, can't be controlled.
I think that's right. I think it is, in fact, an argument against democracy as conceived by Jean-Jacques Rousseau. But Rousseau himself thought that this could only exist in a very small polity. He didn't think a nation state of many millions could possibly be really democratic. And that was a common view until the late 18th century, when people in America decided to try it. And we can decide how well that has worked out. But it was widely said at the time that this couldn't work because democracy is only suited to small communities and not to big nations.
Yes.
Right. Okay. That's interesting. Well, it doesn't preclude other revolutions that have been called Marxist, but which in your view, the Russian Revolution, the Chinese Revolution, the various smaller communist revolutions have been, they're not, in your view, proper Marxist revolutions.
Right. And in practice, what happened was that, Marx has this idea of moving from capitalism to communism. What happened was that then in 1917, Lenin introduced a distinction between socialism and communism as successive stages. And so after the Bolsheviks decided that there wasn't going to be a world revolution and they were on their own, they said, we're going to build socialism and then communism. That's something that wouldn't have meant anything to Marx. So what happened was they devised the Soviet system, which we could say a lot about, but that's, probably would take us too far afield. But they said, we're moving toward full communism, as they called it. And by that, they meant what Marx meant by communism, because they couldn't get over the fact that Marx, their great scripture, their great prophet, had said there would be no money and no markets at all in a communist society. So they relegated it to the distant future. And so both in Soviet Russia and in the People's Republic of China, that was the official doctrine. We've got socialism and we're moving towards full communism. So they still retain that idea of abolishing money and abolishing markets eventually, but it was postponed.
So to adapt to pragmatic circumstances, these revolutions occurred in backward countries as well, which is another thing that Marx thought they would occur in the more advanced industrial
Absolutely. Yeah, that's true. I mean, Marx was convinced, and all his early followers believed, that Germany, France, Britain, and also the United States, although, of course, there was this problem for Marxism. There was a Marxist whose name was Werner Zombart, who actually later became a National Socialist. So he hitched his wagon to a different star. When he was a Marxist, he wrote a famous book called Why Is There No Socialism in the United States? And he came up with various arguments, because there was a problem for Marxism, because the United States was the most advanced industrial country, and therefore it should be in the forefront of socialism. So in all the European countries, there was a major socialist party, but not in the United States. There was a socialist party, but it was tiny, never got beyond single digits as a percentage of the vote. So that was a problem for Marxism. But even when Lenin seized power, he said, well, we're doing this because we're only going to have to wait a short time before the revolution occurs in Germany. And there was a revolution in Germany, there was revolutionary uprisings in 1919, but it was a failed revolution. They didn't succeed in retaining power. But you know, there was Rosa Luxemburg, there was Karl Liebknecht, there were leading revolutionary socialists who thought they were getting close to seizing power for a while in Germany. The situation was in flux for a while, but if you look at it coldly, there was never the slightest chance they could have succeeded, actually.
It was due to the chaos after the First World War, and the chaos was bigger in Russia than it was in these other places.
Yeah. Exactly.
So finally on Marx, I mean, those are good arguments. I mean, certainly if you define Marxism like you have done, that it's impossible, or, well, impossible in the claim you're making.
Yeah.
So, I mean, you could also just look at the historical record, that it looked for a while like, if you assume the others were Marx's revolution, that it was advancing. But 1989, 91, the collapse of the Soviet Union and the changeover in China from a pure-ish communist system, or what they thought was, to a hybrid system of two systems, one country, in 1978 under Deng Xiaoping, that pretty much looks, for now anyway, the end of it, that it's more a rise and fall rather than a continued advance of an ideology.
Right.
Yeah, that's interesting. My next question, this intrigued me. I asked one of my friends, who was the most evil man in history? And we were all thinking, well, Mao, Stalin, Hitler, Genghis Khan. Nobody would have thought Immanuel Kant.
Right. Well, there was a woman who became very popular named Ayn Rand, and she got a following. And the name of her movement is Objectivism. There are still thousands of people who worship Ayn Rand and everything she wrote. You have to understand that this is a cult. There are lots of devotees of Ayn Rand. And I'm, in particular, there is a guy called Stephen Hicks, who has written this book that is the main topic of that chapter. And he restates what Ayn Rand said. Now, Ayn Rand said, quote, that Immanuel Kant is the most evil man in mankind's history, end quote. That was what she thought. People who follow Ayn Rand think that Immanuel Kant was an evil person who preached evil things, and they make it their business to disparage Immanuel Kant and suggest that they suggest that everything that's horrible about the modern world, like the Gulag and Auschwitz and the wokeism and postmodernism, that all these things are due to Immanuel Kant, right? Stephen Hicks wrote this book on postmodernism where he actually says postmodernism is all due to Kant. And he had a good relationship with Jordan Peterson. And so Jordan Peterson has given a boost to Stephen Hicks. Now, Jordan Peterson actually, as I point out in this chapter, there are many parallels between the Ayn Rand movement in the 1960s and the Jordan Peterson movement 50 years later. They both have this guru or prophet who is the leader, and they have lots of people doting on every word of the leader. They're both viewed as right-wing movements. They both make claims about all kinds of subjects, like literary theory, religion, all kinds of subjects. Ayn Rand thought that there were the two greatest novelists were Victor Hugo and Fyodor Dostoevsky, and she thought that modern novelists like James Joyce and Franz Kafka were absolutely despicable trash. And if you became a follower of Ayn Rand, you had to agree with her on things like that. And she also thought that it was a great thing to smoke cigarettes, and that was a kind of sacrament. Apart from some very crude similarities, Ayn Rand and Jordan Peterson are not at all similar, except that they're anti-socialist and in favor of personal development. They're not really similar. But there is this one connection that Stephen Hicks got on with Jordan Peterson, and Jordan Peterson said some nice things about Stephen Hicks. They both dislike postmodernism, and they both blame postmodernism for a lot of things. And by the way, I would say that Ayn Rand and Jordan Peterson both, it's a characteristic of both of them, that they're, and I don't mean this in an unkind way, they're extremely ignorant of some things where they lay down the law about. For example, Jordan Peterson says that until the 18th century or maybe the 17th century, nobody had any concept of objective reality. That's one of the things he says. Of course, that's absolutely incredible, crushing ignorance of the pre-Socratics or the people in ancient Sumer. It's just dotty. The point I try to make in this chapter is that Immanuel Kant did not hold the things that Ayn Rand attributed to him. There's two main things that followers of Ayn Rand say about Immanuel Kant. One is that he denied the existence of objective reality or denied that we could know anything about it. That is absolutely false. It was actually one of Kant's preoccupations, defend and validate objective truth as applied to an external world of physical objects, and to show that this could be defended. One thing that's very unclear in Ayn Rand and in the Randist movement is why, if you do believe there's no such thing as objective reality or we can't know about it, why would that make you collectivist? Why would that make you more inclined to support the Gulag and the Holocaust? So that's very unclear. But then another thing that Ayn Rand believed that in rational self-interest as the basis of morality. Her most famous book, apart from her two very famous novels, is called The Virtue of Selfishness. She argued that self-interest was the root of morality. Nothing could be wrong if it was done out of self-interest. So one of the things she did in her arguments was anybody who rejected that view, she accused them of holding that the opposite of self-interest was the basis of morality. So if you don't accept Ayn Rand's view that self-interest is the basis of morality, then you must accept the view that self-sacrifice, the denial of self-interest, is the basis of morality. Well, of course, that's absolute nonsense. most systems of morality are neither totally self-interested or totally contrary to self-interest. Mm. Most systems of morality allow a place for self-interest, but argue that it can be excessive, it can be taken too far, and that there are cases where you have to go against your self-interest. Now, so Ayn Rand argued that Immanuel Kant was in favor of self-sacrifice. Well, this is completely wrong. Immanuel Kant did not take that view. He was a great believer in human freedom. Immanuel Kant was actually a libertarian, or as people would have said 100 years ago, a classical liberal. Immanuel Kant believed in individual freedom, political, social, and in every other way.
Yeah, that's my reading of him as well. I mean, I'm more familiar with perpetual peace and what he said about international relations, but yeah, its roots are in, as you say, liberalism of the early 19th century, which is when he was around, and he was chaffing against the various authoritarian, which in those days were like kings, monarchies, and so forth, and looking to liberalism, and then trying to get rid of the problem of war. So,
and he's also famous for the tract, "What is the Enlightenment? What is Enlightenment?" in which he's quite clearly a classical liberal.
Yes, yeah.
Down to the individual level.
You can disagree with him on that. I mean, I'm not convinced of with perpetual peace. I don't think it's workable. But to move on and call him evil just seems really, you know.
Yeah. I should say that the view that Kant thought that we can't know reality, I think is wrong. It's a false view, but it is very common. That's a common view outside Brandis circles. In fact, two of the most influential books about Kant, the book by Strawson, argue that there is a problem. I mean, people who argued like that usually didn't say Kant is against knowledge of, or says we can't know objective reality, and therefore we can't know objective reality. They usually said Kant says that we don't know objective reality, and therefore there's something wrong with Kant's theory. So even there, it doesn't really support Ayn Rand's interpretation, because Kant did not make a lot of converts to the view that we can't know. Even if you think he did preach that we can't know reality, he didn't convince modern philosophers of that at all. You know, that's there is actually a survey of the views of modern philosophers. It's about 10 or 20 years ago, of thousands of modern philosophers, and it shows that the vast majority of them, more than 90%, are realists in the sense that they think there are objective truths about the external world. Generally speaking, followers of Ayn Rand tend to be ignorant about what philosophers actually believe. Now, Stephen Hicks, that's not true. He knows a lot about the history of philosophy. But, you know, this is a common occurrence, actually, that you'll get some prophet, leader of a cult, and then they will have a disciple who is much more erudite than they are, and yet defends their ill-informed views. It's a curious thing. But so Stephen Hicks knows a lot about the history of philosophy, but he has to twist and turn to misrepresent the history of philosophy in order to defend Ayn Rand.
Would never have happened under Marx, would it?
Because there's a connection, as I was saying, between you, David, and Roger, and Orwell, and that is the Second World War.
That's where there's overlap, isn't there, between Orwell's attitude to the build-up in the 30s, between pacifism and do we confront Hitler? And he changes his mind, doesn't he?
Yes.
In surprising ways, Well, suddenly changes his mind.
On that. Well, I mean, so he changes his mind on socialism a little bit as well.
Well, a big bit, but that was early, and he remained a socialist then for the rest of his life. But, I think there's a lot of misconceptions about what Orwell believed. And part of this is due to the fact that he changed his mind quite dramatically on a number of occasions. So if you try and reconcile what he said on different time periods, it doesn't make much sense. You might just reach completely false conclusions. Mm. So he changed his mind. The 5 points where he changed his mind. Once was when he decided not to stay in the Imperial Police Force in Burma, but to come back to England and devote himself full time to the life of a writer, a freelance writer, essentially. So that was in 1927. The next thing I would say was when he was converted to socialism, the next big thing. And he had been an anti-socialist. In fact, there was he had been called a Tory anarchist. And I think that was a label that he accepted at one point. But then in the middle of 1936, when he was working on a book called The Road to Wigan Pier, he became a definite convert to socialism. Then he went to fight in Spain. And in May 1937, he adopted a new view, which was to dominate him for the rest of his life. And that was strong opposition to the Communist Party. He had been a socialist with a lot of sympathy for the Communist Party, with some objections, but he moved from being someone who really detested the Communist Party. And that was because of something that happened to him while he was fighting in Spain. So that was in May 1937. He had to get out of Spain and get back to England because the Communists or people allied with the Communists had taken over in Catalonia, and he could easily have been arrested and tortured and killed. So he came back to Britain and found that lots of media were repeating the Communist Party line on Spain, and he objected to it. And then he wrote the book Homage to Catalonia, which is putting his own view. So he now becomes a strong adherent of what I call the revolutionary anti-Stalinist left, which a lot of people will say is Trotskyism, but it's actually much bigger than Trotskyism. And that's his attitude from, let's say, May, June 1937 until September 1939. And part of the view of the revolutionary anti-Stalinist left was to be this is a complicated thing, but I'll just state it as a fact. It is a fact that part of the view held by these people was that they were opposed to the coming war with Germany. They took what is sometimes called a pacifist line, although that's a bit misleading, an anti-war line on the coming war with Germany. Now, here it gets all, you might think I'm making this up, but it's true. On a particular morning in September 1939, Orwell had a dream. And after he woke up from this dream, he says he realized that he would support the war against Germany. And from then on, he became a really enthusiastic supporter of the war. So that's the fourth big change. And what that meant was he was no longer on the same page as the ILP, for example, and other people who were involved in this revolutionary and anti-Stalinist left. Then the last major change in his views would be less sudden, but still quite definite within a couple of years. And that was his changing from being a revolutionary socialist who in favor of blood in the streets and armed uprising and that sort of thing, to being a purely parliamentary socialist. So that is more or less wrapped up by 1944. So from 1944 on, he is nobody will know what this means except Roger. He was a Bevanite.
Yes.
He was a supporter of an Iron Bevin and Michael Foot and people like that. And he remained that way until his death in January 1950.
Right. Yeah. So he moves then from not communist, but with sympathizers for them, first of all, to socialism. A revolutionary socialist, as you would call it, but against the sort of Stalinist hard line on communism. So again, that links in with what you were saying earlier about Lyshenkoism and the dogmatism of the Communist Party and driving away some sympathetic people to it because it was so dogmatic. And then finally, he moves from a revolutionary socialism to a parliamentary version of socialism and promoting socialism through the democratic system. So the other dilemma, of course, for all these people on the left was how to deal in the 30s with the fascism, Germany, Nazism, if you like. And he's not the only one to move. Russia, Stalin, in the early 30s, they thought, you know, there was a big clash coming with Germany. And then later on, they change as well, of course. And you have the Nazi-Soviet Ribbentrop-Molotov Pact in 1939. So what's happening there inside Russia is it's a pragmatic response to the way the world is moving between the German Nazism, fascism, and the democratic countries. And they're just trying to survive and build, again, linking to what you were saying earlier about socialism in one country. So they're looking at their options there and what's the best thing to do and tackle. Right.
And in fact, it's remarkable that George Orwell and the Communist Party of Great Britain switched places on almost the same day, that Orwell moved from being against the coming war to being enthusiastically in favor of it on almost the same day that the communists, under the direction of Moscow, of course, moved from being strongly anti-Hitler to campaigning for acceptance of Hitler's peace terms. And that was their position until, as we all know, June 22nd, 1941, when Hitler took that
double-crossing out of Stalin, yes. Of course, yeah. So why did Orwell then move from a pacifist appeasement type thinking to opposing... Sorry,
this
to
is an interesting
opposing Hitler this is and an, supporting the war. So this is early 1939 he does this, is it?
Late 1939. It's
right.
I said September, that was wrong, it's August. So it's about a week before the actual declaration of war.
Oh, right, at the last minute then. Okay.
That he changed. And there were a lot of people who changed in that direction. I mean, Bertrand Russell wrote a book arguing against a war with Hitler called Which Way to Peace? And then Russell changed his view and said, we've got to support this war against Hitler. That was the general drift in what I call the narrow left, which would take a bit of defining, but what I call the narrow left tended to be anti-war because of the memory of the First World War.
Yes.
And the idea was we were tricked by being made to support the war because in order to fight Prussian militarism. And now they're trying to trick us to support the war in order to fight Nazism. What happened was that a lot of the people who thought like that, they thought after a while, oh, it's not a trick. Hitler is really, really bad. And we have to support this war. And so one of them was Orwell.
What happens there? You've got September then.
Sorry, can I ask you to reorient?
We've lost your chin again.
No, your chin's gone.
Yeah. Well, you know. I am English. I am English, and it's often said by other nationalities that the English have no chins.
Is
so
okay.
I'm here to abolish that, reject and refute that notion. Just in case.
so he goes with the changes of the time. In September 1938, you've got the Munich Agreement, where it was supposed to be peace in our time. Chamberlain waving his piece of paper. They come to an agreement with Hitler over what was the Czechoslovakian crisis. Then in March 1939, 6 months later, Hitler double-crosses that agreement and he takes the rest of Czechoslovakia, not the bits of the German population. And that's the kind of big turning point then, because people are thinking, well, he's not just got a justifiable aim, so uniting Germans, he's now taking over another country that doesn't really, really want him. And then it's only another 6 months then before Poland becomes the target. And they're thinking now he's a definite aggressor. He's not got a reasonable case. So that is a general drift of opinion in Britain and France at that time. So Orwell goes with that.
So Orwell was just following the drift.
Yes,
he was going with the flow.
He was going
that was one,
yeah, yeah.
That's one of your points.
Well,
David,
yeah,
isn't it?
Well, yeah. I mean, Orwell is much more in harmony with other leftists of the time than people think. They tend to accept, or Orwell projects in his writing the idea that he's a maverick, he's a dissenter, he doesn't get on with the conventional view. Actually, he was a very conventional leftist. And if you look at his political views, he was a very conventional leftist. Now, there were different segments of the left who differed on different issues. But at all times, he was completely in agreement with one major segment of the left, always. It's just that that segment changed once or twice. Now, asking why he changed specifically in August 1939, when he talks about it in retrospect, he talks as though he makes it sound as though he just had an upwelling of patriotic feeling. But in fact, if you look at the arguments he gave then in support of the war, you realize it's more to it than that. He actually had a change of conviction about what was the right thing to do, or the most productive thing to do. And, you know, that he, by the way, when he became a strong proponent of the war, for a couple of years, you see, because he became a strong proponent of the war, he could get a job at the BBC. And that's what he did. And so he was in charge of these broadcasts and scripting various discussions and things like that. Because he was, so that was his view. So Orwell, you know, became this very pro-war person, and full of contempt in his writing for pacifists and people like that. You would never guess to read some of the things he said that he's attacking the very position he had held very recently. You know, this is a complete sort of switch.
Mm. So what I was going to say
was this: immediately after that conversion, he took the view, and he said this repeatedly over and over again. He's absolutely in favor of this war against Germany. We can't possibly win this war without a socialist revolution.
Ah.
So he said that for several years as the war went on. And
what did the BBC think about that?
It was a common view. You know, J.B. Priestley gave radio talks that were very popular, and he essentially took that view. He essentially said we can't win this war unless we have, he didn't necessarily say a socialist revolution, unless we have a sort of profound equalitarian change. You know,
interestingly, in Britain at that, well, Britain's organisation for World War II was semi-socialist. There was a lot of central organisation, planning, and so forth, in mobilisation and production.
Yes,
not to communism, but didn't just leave it completely to the free market and politically.
But Orwell didn't mean that. What he actually didn't mean that. What he meant when he said we must have a socialist revolution, well, first of all, the ruling class must be overthrown and possibly killed. But apart from that, what he really meant was extreme democratization, and that never happened. Of course, British army was far less democratic than the German army at the time. It was much harder for an enlisted man to become an officer. Yes. It wasn't like the German army where they were looking out for talented people who could become officers.
Yes, which is why they're so good at fighting.
Yeah, right.
compared to ours, we still have the vestige of the class system.
Actually, one of the few.
You can say that. I mean, there's been studies done that show that in terms of pure military efficiency, the Germans were a better army than the British, French, and Americans. And you can probably say that to analytical level without mixing in any sympathy for the political regime.
Right. And every time the Germans won, Orwell would say, well, this shows the superiority of a socialist system. They're beating us because they have a socialist system. But, you know, there is one case I know of a private who was suddenly elevated to the officer class. You know who I'm talking about?
Well, in Britain.
In Britain, yeah. Enoch Powell.
A private.
Enoch Powell.
Enoch Powell, was he? Right.
Yeah. He enlisted as a private. And then subsequently, some officer said something to him. And Powell replied with a Greek tag. And this officer thought, well, what's this? And anyway, they had a conversation, and then he was recommended. And I forget how he ended up, what rank he got, but he was an officer from then on.
Okay, I didn't know that. But yeah, you're right. Generally, there were class barriers, yeah. And of course, Britain also moved to the left during the war as well, was the other point. So I was just going to...
Right, yeah.
Not as far left as revolutionary socialism, but...
Right.
It does. It's interesting.
The Flynn effect, I think David has a interesting new conjecture in sort of gynecology, I suppose you would.
Yeah, I mean, that's one way of looking at it. Yeah.
What's the Flynn effect then, for people who've never heard of it?
The Flynn effect is the well-documented, very rapid and very continuous increase in measured IQ, which began no later than the First World War, but may have begun before the year 1900, and has continued until very recently. Or now there is some notion that maybe it has stalled and maybe going into reverse in some countries. Beginning in industrialized countries and then spreading to other countries, there was this very very big increase in IQ continuously for a century. And there is no absolutely settled view. There are various theories about what caused it. So my theory, which I put forward in one chapter in this book, is that this is due to the growing availability of cesarean section. In other words, babies with bigger heads could survive birth. And incidentally, so could their mothers who had the genes for babies with bigger heads. So that, and there is a correlation, definite correlation between head size, skull diameter, or actually circumference is the usual measure, between the circumference of the skull and IQ, adult IQ. So that's my theory. And I put it forward in this chapter and deal with various objections to it. And I also spell out what would refute it, how it could be refuted. It's not about the same kind of topics as the rest of the book.
Is that then looking at the population as a whole, or is it just looking at the ones that have had cesarean births?
Well, cesarean births would always be more likely to be given to difficult births, and difficult births are very largely due to the size of the head. At birth, the head is the biggest diameter thing that has to get through the vaginal opening, right? So most difficult births are due to head size. So this is an interesting thing about the evolution of the human species.
What I meant was that the database, is it looking at those who've had cesarean births and therefore, as you say, have got greater head size compared to looking at their IQs and seeing if they've increased? Or is it looking at the population overall and correlating that with the increase in IQs?
I'm not sure I get the question. I don't understand the question.
Right, okay. So if the idea is cesarean births are leading to an increase in IQs, you could look at those who've had cesarean births, which isn't going to be a huge proportion, is it, of the population, see if they've got higher IQs than the average.
In the United States, it's a third of the population have and in many countries it's more than 50%.
Right. Okay. Wow. All right. Well, that's a lot, isn't it? Yeah, that is a lot. Yeah.
There is another way in which cesarean birth would increase IQ, a completely independent way in which it would increase IQ, but it's not in the genes, and so it's not cumulative, and that is damage to the skull caused by the trauma of birth, so to speak, to use a psychoanalytic term. So babies, they often have beanies, little caps put on them, and it's because it's so unsightly that their skulls have been, because the skull is very soft. And one of the reasons it's very soft, according to evolutionary theory, is because to allow bigger head size to coexist with the problems of birth. So it starts to harden up after birth. Prior to birth, the skull is very vulnerable. It's soft and easily mangled and damaged. Most babies who are born vaginally have very observable mutilations of the skull. This is true to such an extent that if you have a baby who's born vaginally and has no damage to the skull evident, the medical staff will always half jokingly say that this looks like a cesarean birth, where the skull is totally undamaged. Now, of course, there is an intermediate stage because there are cases where they try by labor for hours and that damages the skull, and then there's a cesarean. That happens. So it's not a clean-cut thing. So that's a different way in which cesarean birth would... And, of course, this came to my mind because we had four children in rapid succession, and all of them were born by cesarean, and all of them are extremely bright. This put this idea into my mind. So Sam Harris exploded into public awareness from nowhere in 2004 because he published a book called The End of Faith. And in that book, he accomplished a number of things, I think. But anyway, he thinks that suicide bombings occur because people have certain religious beliefs, and that's an end to the matter. So he thinks, basically, since he wrote that book, it's become more clear that he is very strongly anti-Muslim, and actually says that although that book, the gist of that book is that all religion is bad and harmful and leads to atrocities, he's more likely to, in recent years, to have said, oh, Christianity and Judaism are not so bad. It's Islam that is the big enemy. So he thinks that the reason that suicide bombings occur is because of Islam, and because it says in the Quran that you have to kill the infidel, right? So that's his theory. And I point out there are various problems with this theory. I mean, one problem would be there were no suicide bombings by Muslims before 1981. None. So what happened in 1981 and what happened... and there weren't many from between 1981 and 1983. In 1983, there was a hugely successful suicide bombing, and that was
Beirut, wasn't it?
In Lebanon.
Beirut, a lot of American Marines were killed.
American Marines were killed by one person. This suddenly alerted people to the fact that with suicide bombing, you had a much better chance of taking out a lot of the enemy. But the people actually took most advantage of this in the years that followed were not Muslims. And this is something that Sam Harris is totally innocent of all these details, or at least he was then. And that they were the Tamil Tigers in Sri Lanka. They were the biggest practitioners of suicide bombing in the 1980s. Of course, you have to understand that suicide bombers are intelligent people who, we used to say, who read the newspapers. Of course, there are no newspapers anymore, but they keep up with the news. So the Tamil Tigers, who were fighting for autonomy in Sri Lanka, and they're all atheists. The Tamil Tigers are they're Marxists. They're all of Hindu background. They're strongly opposed to all theistic religion, and they say so. They're big preachers of atheism. They became the biggest perpetrators of suicide bombing. And obviously they read about this case in the Lebanon, which led to the withdrawal of Ronald Reagan was not an idiot. And Ronald Reagan saw this and withdrew the troops from Lebanon. And a little bit later, the French withdrew their troops as well, because they had a suicide bombing. It wasn't quite as dramatic, but it was dramatic enough. So people woke up to the fact, in the early 1980s, people woke up to the fact that suicide bombing was tremendously effective. And it's been calculated that if you're prepared to die in the attempt to kill the enemy, you can take out 12 times as many of the enemy as if you're trying to save your own life. So that's one thing. Another thing about this whole suicide bombing is it's clear that Sam Harris didn't know that there were Christian suicide bombers. In fact, it's generally true that most people who think of and talk about the Palestinians don't realize that there were Christian Palestinians who were just as much into resistance or terrorism, take your pick, as the Muslims. In fact, more so.
So we're talking about suicide bombing and its connection or not with political straw religious ideologies.
Yeah, is it a political issue or is it a religious issue? Well, I think that's a way of framing it.
Not quite.
Because
sure.
I think Sam Harris wants to push the idea, he did in The End of Faith, that it is a question of religious. It's a religious motivation. But as I think we agree, that suicide bombing is just a means to an end.
It's
a
military.
In this case, it's a political end. I'll let maybe.
Yes. I mean, even if there is a religious motivation, I mean, you know, there was a religious motivation among the Roundheads in the English Civil War, but it was Cromwell who said, trust in God and keep your powder dry. In other words, you have to pay attention to what works as well as trusting in God. And I think I'm sure there is some religious motivation for the Palestinian resistance. And I'm sure that there are many religious motives among the Catholics in the IRA. I mean, you know, these are not cleanly excisable, you know. But the point is, I think that Robert Pape, by the way, has written two books, and he compiled a database of all recorded suicide bombings, and he analyzed them. And his conclusion is that the cause of the great majority of suicide bombings that have occurred since 1981 is, and this applies to Muslims and non-Muslims alike, is the desire of a militarily weak ethnic group to fight back against foreign occupation, or what they perceive as foreign occupation. You know, at the time of 9/11, the US had a lot of troops in Saudi Arabia. They later withdrew them. In other words, the operation was a success. You know, looking at it, is it religious? Or I mean, I think it is political, but it may be driven partly by religious motives. That doesn't mean that the only reason people are suicide bombers is because of what the Quran says. That's
right.
You know,
yeah, this
you'd
is
have to explain
fine.
Why for centuries there were no suicide bombings until 1981. You know, and then you'd have to explain why lots of people who never read the Quran, including a lot of atheists and a lot of Christians, committed suicide bombings after 1981.
Right. I think from a military strategy, international politics point of view, you've got to look at it, first of all, as a military tactic. It's a military tactic of a weak actor because they're outmatched during conventional warfare. You can go back to World War II with the Japanese suicide pilots, and the calculation there was that because they training was very, very poor by that stage in the war, that they could inflict more damage. They were going to get shot down anyway, more or less,
in one or
two sorties.
Yeah.
So if they were going to die anyway, they might as well try and attack and take an American ship with them and inflict greater damage. So that's, from a rational point of view, it's a little bit perverted, but it does sound rational point of view of why they did it. And as you say, after 1981... it's proved to be quite successful, more effective than conventional sort of guerrilla warfare or terrorism or whatever. So it's primarily a military tactic. Military is the instrument of a political or religious cause, going back to Clausewitz. Okay, it's an extension of war, of politics or religion, if you're religious politics, by other means, and therefore a tactic that is available. So that's the main reason why it's done. Now, just slightly towards Harris, obviously the cause you have to be committed to the cause and willing to die for it. So maybe the Muslim cause is fairly fanatical, as the Japanese cause was in World War II. And there are some causes that wouldn't be prepared to do suicide bombing as a tactic. Britain, I mean, I can't imagine many British people or Americans willing to do that. There are examples of Americans doing it. There was in the Battle of Midway, there was an American pilot who was severely damaged and his aircraft was going down and he targeted it on a Japanese ship. But, you know, it's an extreme and specific case, really. So
yeah, I think in all national cultures, you have the idea that it's a good thing to die in order to defeat the enemy. It's not a novel thing. When I was a kid growing up in England in the 1950s, it was common for people talked a lot about the war, of course, and it was common for people to quote the words of Jesus: "Greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends." And they applied that to fighting the Germans in the Second World War.
Yeah.
And it's if you look at German, if you look at British or American war movies, you often see this motif of someone who knows he's going to die in what, and it's considered glorious and particularly praiseworthy that they were that committed that they were prepared to die. You know, I don't think that there's anything specifically Muslim about this. Of course, you have to be passionately committed to the cause to be willing to do that. But there's no shortage of people passionately committed to various causes.
Who's he directed to then? What sort of people?
Well, it's directed at possibly mythical creature, the intelligent general reader. But it's directed to people interested in politics, interested in matters of public controversy. I think it will probably arouse more interest than it's a sequel to my other collection of essays, The Mystery of Fascism, which was subtitled David Ramsay Steele's Greatest Hits.
Mm.
Well, this one is subtitled David Ramsay Steele's Legendary Lost Lectures. I've written 7 books. 2 of them were co-authored. The book which has easily done best commercially, selling the most, is a book I wrote jointly with a psychotherapist named Michael Edelstein, and it's called 3-Minute Therapy. And that has sold far more copies than any of my other books. And it's still selling. It's still alive. You know, it's in a second paperback edition. It hasn't cracked 100,000 sales, but it's getting up there. My next was Atheism Explained, which was published in 2008, and which many reviewers said was the best popular short defense of atheism or case for atheism. And I agree with them. I think it is. that's done well. The book I'm most pleased with generally as a work of scholarship is my book about George Orwell. It's a book about George Orwell's beliefs and how they changed. And it's contrary to much received wisdom about Orwell. Apart from that, my first book came out in 1992. It seems like a forgotten age. And it's about the economic calculation problem. It's called From Marx to Mises. And people still do argue about it, talk about it. And then there's a sequel to 3-Minute Therapy called Therapy Breakthrough, where I first included a chapter about Sigmund Freud, the conquistador with his pants down. And my other two books are collections. There's the collection, The Mystery of Fascism, David Ramsay Steele's Greatest Hits. You might think from the cover it's Greatest Tits, but actually it's Greatest Hits. And then there is this one, The Conquistador with His Pants Down, David Ramsay Steele's Legendary Lost Lectures, which I'm hoping will do better than any of the previous 6.
Well, I think it's a truly fantastic book, very readable, full of humour and some very valuable insights.
Well, that just shows what a percipient person you are.
And it's a book that I think you can return to.
I can all concur.
Yeah.
So thank you very much.
Thanks, David.
You know, it has been demonstrated that the more copies of a book you buy, you know, the ideas in books go through the air and get into your brains. You don't have to read the books. The important thing is to buy them. And the more copies of the book you buy, the more powerful that effect. So you're educating yourself to a much greater extent if you buy 10 copies of a book than if you only buy one.
Just by buying it, right, okay.
Yeah, it speeds up the osmosis.
Does it?
Yeah.
Right, okay. I don't know whether that's in free market economics somewhere. Or whether Marx would agree with that. Or Kant for
okay.
that matter.
It's been a delightful conversation. Thank you, David, as usual.
Well,
thank you very much.
Thank you very much for the opportunity to expand my ideas, which I always will take if I get it.
Yeah, you're welcome.
Great.
So, look forward to the next interaction.
And the next.
Yeah.